crane has long been considered a sacred bird by Japan's Aboriginal Ainu people. In fact, it has been the best-loved bird throughout Japan since ancient times. In Japan, this elegant bird symbolizes long life and prosperity. And crane motifs are found in many aspects of Japanese life. But this sacred bird was once on the brink of extinction. Some Japanese have dedicated their lives to raising cranes to help preserve the species. And in recent years, a special veterinary clinic has been working to return injured cranes to the wild. On this edition of Begin Japanology, we look at cranes and the long-standing fascination they have held for the people of Japan.
Hello and welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barakan. Our theme for today is cranes, not the type that you find on construction sites, but the avian variety. These birds have been much loved in Japan for many, many years. There are 15 species of cranes all over the world, of which three account for the majority of cranes in Japan. This one here is the white-naped crane, and there are about 1,000 of these to be found in Kagoshima Prefecture, way down in the south of Kyushu. Another species to be found in Japan is the hooded crane, again in Kagoshima Prefecture and also in Yamaguchi Prefecture in the west. And then there's this one, which is the red-crowned crane. Both the white-naped and the hooded crane are migratory birds which spend their winters in Japan. But these red-crowned cranes spend their whole year here, and they breed here in Japan as well. And when Japanese people think about cranes, first and foremost, these are the ones that come to mind. And these red-crowned cranes are the ones that we're going to focus on today.
The vast marshes of the Kushiro Plain on Japan's northern main island, Hokkaido. This is Japan's largest swamp, occupying 18,000 hectares. The red-crowned crane lives in these marshes throughout the year. Thanks to plenty of underground springs, parts of the marshes never freeze, and the cranes can obtain food all year long. There are about 1,000 of them living here. Non-migratory cranes like these are a rarity. Red-crowned cranes stand about 140 centimeters tall, making them The Japanese name for the red-crowned crane is Tancho. Tan means red, and Cho means top of the head. So this species got its name from its appearance. Cranes are known for forming almost inseparable mating pairs. They exhibit great affection and remain together until death. That's why in Japan, cranes are a symbol of harmonious married life. And that is why crane motifs are widely used on wedding clothing and accessories. The lifespan of a crane is between 30 and 60 years. They're among the most long-lived of all birds. The traditional belief was that cranes live 1,000 years and turtles 10,000. Consequently, both animals symbolize long life, and that is why they're often depicted on hanging scrolls and sliding doors. Origami, the Japanese art of paper folding. Cranes are perhaps the most common origami theme. There's a belief in Japan that if you fold 1,000 paper cranes, your wish will come true. So paper cranes are often given as get-well gifts. The color combination red and white is considered lucky in Japan. So the red-crowned crane, with its pure white wings and red head, has been seen as a symbol of happiness for this reason as well. There are many Japanese folk tales about cranes bringing good fortune. Here's a famous one entitled Tsuru no Ongaishi, which means a crane returns a favor. Once upon a time, an old man found a crane caught in a trap and freed it. One snowy night, a young woman appeared at the house of the old man and his wife.
"I've lost my way. May I please stay the night here?"
she asked. The kind-hearted old couple graciously offered her hospitality. From the next day on, the girl remained in her room day after day, weaving beautiful fabric for the old couple. Thanks to her, the old couple became very wealthy. But one day, when the couple peeked into the girl's room, they saw that the cloth was being woven not by a girl, but by a crane. And it was weaving fabric out of its pure white feathers. With its true form revealed, the crane told the old couple that it could no longer remain with them. The old couple tried to stop the crane, but it flew off into the sky. This tale depicts the crane as a bird that brings happiness. There are companies that have used this positive image of the crane in their branding. For example, Japan's major airline, JAL. Recently, the airline suffered bankruptcy. In January 2011, as part of a restructuring, JAL executives announced that the airline's old logo would be revived. This logo, featuring a crane, was first adopted in 1959. It's an image indelibly associated with the era of Japan's economic miracle. Now this symbol of JAL's golden age is being brought back to represent a fresh start, as the airline hopes to regain its former glory. The crane is deeply embedded in so many aspects of Japanese society, and it's still thought of as a sacred bird with the power to answer prayers.
When you live in Japan, cranes pop up in all sorts of different situations. For example, let's start off with, here you see, you've got a pair of red crowned cranes here on the back of an old 1,000 yen note. Next, let's see, where have I got, here we go. See a picture of a crane there on a traditional card from a Japanese card game. And there's all sorts of different pictures. This one is the crane, and you'll see it's a kind of a pine blossom there as well. And both of those are auspicious designs. And in my other pocket, let's see, here we go. This is one of those little bags that you put cash in when to give to somebody for a congratulatory present. When you have a crane like this, and this is a paper cord, by the way, which is very intricately put together, the crane is used for marriage ceremonies or sometimes engagement ceremonies, pretty special times. Okay, let's move on now and look at the history of the Japanese relationship with cranes.
The Japanese view of the crane as a sacred bird has its roots in ancient China. In Chinese legend, the sages were depicted as riding on cranes. The sages were said to have flown throughout China on craneback, bringing good fortune to the people. It was during samurai times that the crane motif became widespread in Japan. Around Edo, as Tokyo was then known, there were many wetlands where red-crowned cranes were a common sight. In those days, the cranes would migrate during the winter from the northern island of Hokkaido to Japan's largest island, Honshu, returning north in the spring. At one time, these migratory birds were eaten as a delicacy. The Miyagi Prefectural Library preserves the bill of fare from an occasion when the local samurai lord, Date Masamune, welcomed the shogun. Crane meat was used mainly in soups. It was prized in the belief that eating it would grant longevity. The crane's wintering areas were also used as hunting grounds by the shogun. Meat from cranes that had been taken by falconry was a prestigious food, sometimes presented to feudal lords who had done great service for the shogun. In accord with this status, the common people were forbidden to hunt cranes. This meant that cranes were largely left at peace when wintering. But in the late 19th century, Japan's new modern government pursued the development But in 1924, an astonishing piece of news was reported. Deep within the Kushiro marshes of Hokkaido, a dozen or so cranes had been discovered. Instead of migrating to Honshu in the winter, this flock had survived in these marshes, relying on underground springs. Efforts to restore the red-crowned crane population began immediately. During the winter, when food was scarce, villagers would scatter corn for the cranes. The population of the birds increased greatly over time, from less than 20 individuals to more than 1,000 today. The red-crowned crane, Japan's bird of happiness, has happily made a recovery in the Kushiro marshes.
There are currently 9 red-crowned cranes in Ueno Zoo, and you can see a couple of them here behind me. And their keeper, Mr. Takahashi, is here as well. I'm going to ask him a few questions. Takahashi-san, I know you enticed the cranes over with some food just now. I was wondering what it is you feed them on.
Basically, we give them food pellets, similar to dog food and cat food, but specially made for cranes, and also some fish like weather loach and horse mackerel.
Oh, most cranes migrate. Do they do that for the same reason as other birds do?
Yes, they do migrate for the same reason, which is to find food. Red-crowned cranes that live in cold areas of China and Russia migrate south in the winter when food becomes scarce. But in Japan, red-crowned cranes stay all year long in Hokkaido and do not make seasonal journeys.
Looking at these cranes, the males and the females seem to look very similar to me. How do you tell the difference?
It's nearly impossible to tell them apart by their appearance. However, their calls are different. First, the male makes a loud cry, and then the female answers, uttering 2 calls for each male call. The male and female sound different, so that's how we tell them apart.
Next, we bring you an extraordinary story of a relationship between a man and a crane. This is a digest version of a program that was originally broadcast on NHK in 1987.
Cry for me! Cry for me! Come on! May, when winter's snows have melted. This is the red-crowned crane's egg-laying season. But Kushiro is rainy at the start of spring, posing risks for the eggs. If they get wet, it's not uncommon for parents to abandon them. Today, Takahashi finds two eggs that have been abandoned by their parents. He immediately proceeds to artificially incubate them. The abandoned eggs are quickly placed in an incubator to keep them warm. The inside is maintained at 38 degrees Celsius and 50% humidity, the same conditions found under a brooding mother crane. Every 5 hours, the eggs are taken out and rotated a third of a turn to ensure they are being warmed evenly. Takahashi continues doing this for 30 days, just as a crane parent would. Weeks have passed.
Pichan.
Takahashi calls all of his cranes Pichan.
Pico. Pichan.
He speaks to them frequently at this stage of incubation.
Pico.
Pichan. One egg quivers, seemingly in response to his voice. The 30th day. Finally, the chick begins to break out. Twenty-four hours later, the chick hatches. It's 130 grams and healthy. The first week after hatching is critical to whether a chick will make it to adulthood. Many fall sick right after they're born. Takahashi feeds his chicks small fish, using tweezers to simulate a parent bird's beak. But coaxing a chick to eat the fish isn't easy. It can often take an entire day to get one fish down. It demands perseverance, just as it does for cranes raising young in the wild. June. Takahashi takes the newborn Pichan outside for the first time. He intends to release this bird into the marshes next spring, so it must learn about the rigors of the wild. He teaches Pichan the dangers of predators using vocalizations. The pitch of the call alerts the chicks to danger. Look out sounds like hya, hya. 3 months later. Under Takahashi's care, Pichan has grown so much that it's hard to believe he was recently a tiny chick. Now comes the real test. For a bird as large as a red-crowned crane to fly, a great deal of practice is required. And as Pichan's foster parent, Takahashi must be the one to give flying lessons. Can a human really teach a bird to fly? Let's run. It's been 3 months since hatching. If a crane fails to practice enough at this stage, it will never fly. So Takahashi makes practice runs with Pichan day after day. On the fourth day, Pichan lifts off from the ground. Turn, turn, to the right. Keep flying. Quite a workout, huh? Pichan, you flew. Good bird. I don't know if I'm cut out to be your parent. Thanks to one man's determination to boost the number of wild cranes, Pichan is safely released in the marshes the following spring. Takahashi believes that one day, Pichan will return with his mate.
The man that we just saw in the video, Mr. Ryoji Takahashi, is currently serving as the Director Emeritus of the Japanese Crane Reserve. He's successfully raised 55 cranes to date, and apart from a few that were given to zoos, all the others have been released into the wild. After 50 years of observing red-crowned cranes, Mr. Takahashi says that he still finds things to learn from their conduct. The story we've just seen is about 20 years old. Since then, there are new methods evolving for raising cranes, including, for example, the use of crane costumes and also implements that emulate the beak of the crane for feeding. The increase in the crane population has brought with it problems, though. Next, we're going to meet a vet who cares for cranes.
It has been 50 years since people began feeding and raising red-crowned cranes, and the species is a rare success story in wildlife protection. But new problems are cropping up as the cranes, now no longer so cautious of humans, have been showing up frequently in more populated areas. Kushiro City Zoo in Hokkaido houses Japan's only veterinary clinic that specializes in red-crowned cranes. Most of the cranes brought here have been hurt in accidents. This one has lost part of a wing in a collision with electric power lines. And this bird had its left foot severed in some accident. The clinic's 7 patient rooms are always fully occupied. Ryoji Shimura has been treating cranes here for 30 years. Over that time, he has tended to 300 avian patients. This crane was brought in 2 days ago. It was found under the eaves of a farmhouse. Its body weight is down to 4 kilograms from a typical 8. It got its beak caught in a rubber ring and couldn't eat anything. The crane was probably doing this and stuck its beak in as far as it could go. Shimura puts the weakened bird on an IV. Two days later, the crane has recovered enough to peck at Shimura. But every time he sees an injured crane, Shimura is forced to think about how best to protect the species in the years ahead. You have to weigh the downside of feeding wild cranes. There was an upside to doing it. It helped increase the population when needed. But now we have to consider the downside. The population of red-crowned cranes has been boosted by feeding wild ones. But now the challenge is to find a natural environment that is better suited for cranes to live in. One of the people taking on this challenge is a young veterinarian named Shinobu Ikoma. This crane has been nursed back to health. Ikoma is working to release it into the wild. She doesn't want to see another accident befall it. With the help of veteran crane keepers, she carefully evaluates the best place to release the crane. It needs to be far from human settlements, yet with an adequate food supply. Eventually, she decides on a spot along the stream, 30 kilometers from the nearest town. The thickets along the river will help shield the bird from predators. And underground springs keep this stream from freezing in the winter, so the bird will have plenty of fish and shellfish to feed on. Ikoma has decided that this will provide an environment similar to its original habitat. Getting to the point of releasing this bird into the wild has been a valuable experience for me. I hope to continue with this work. The quest continues to shape a new relationship between humans and red-crowned cranes in Japan.
As we've seen, the crane population is gradually on the rise again, although at one time they were thought to have completely died out. However, there are still problems, and the latest one is bird flu. If the crane population stays concentrated all in one place, there's a chance it could get wiped out by an attack of this disease. So it's now up to humans to try and disperse the cranes and keep them alive. I'll see you again next time.
Next time we look at kitchen knives. With almost 50 varieties, they're an essential tool for creating the visual appeal of Japanese cuisine.
The species to be found in Japan is the hooded crane, again in Kagoshima Prefecture and also in Yamaguchi Prefecture in the west. And then there's this one, which is the red-crowned crane. Both the white-naped and the hooded crane are migratory birds which spend their winters in Japan, but these red-crowned cranes spend their whole year here, and they breed here in Japan as well. And when Japanese people think about cranes, first and foremost, these are the ones that come to mind. And these red-crowned cranes are the ones that we're going to focus on today.
The vast marshes of the Kushiro Plain on Japan's northern main island, Hokkaido. This is Japan's largest swamp, occupying 18,000 hectares. The red-crowned crane lives in these marshes throughout the year. Thanks to plenty of underground springs, parts of the marshes never freeze, and the cranes can obtain food all year long. And that is why crane motifs are widely used on wedding clothing and accessories. The lifespan of a crane is between 30 and 60 years. They're among the most long-lived of all birds. The traditional belief was that cranes live 1,000 years and turtles 10,000. Consequently, both animals symbolize long life, and that is why they're often depicted on hanging scrolls and sliding doors. Origami, the Japanese art of paper folding. Cranes are perhaps the most common origami theme. There's a belief in Japan that if you fold 1,000 paper cranes, your wish will come true. So paper cranes are often given as get-well gifts. The crane has long been considered a sacred bird by Japan's Aboriginal Ainu people. In fact, it has been the best-loved bird throughout Japan since ancient times. In Japan, this elegant bird symbolizes long life and prosperity. And crane motifs are found in many aspects of Japanese life. But this sacred bird was once on the brink of extinction. There are about 1,000 of them living here. Non-migratory cranes like these are a rarity. Red-crowned cranes stand about 140 centimeters tall, making them the Japanese name for the red-crowned crane is Tancho. Tan means red, and Cho means top of the head. So this species got its name from its appearance. Cranes are known for forming almost inseparable mating pairs. They exhibit great affection and remain together until death. That's why in Japan, cranes are a symbol of harmonious married life. Some Japanese have dedicated their lives to raising cranes to help preserve the species. And in recent years, a special veterinary clinic has been working to return injured cranes to the wild. On this edition of Begin Japanology, we look at cranes and the long-standing fascination they have held for the people of Japan.
Hello and welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barakan. Our theme for today is cranes, not the type that you find on construction sites, but the avian variety. These birds have been much loved in Japan for many, many years. There are 15 species of cranes all over the world, of which three account for the majority of cranes in Japan. This one here is the white-naped crane, and there are about 1,000 of these to be found in Kagoshima Prefecture, way down in the south of Kyushu. Another species